Hey guys, I'm Zoe Hewitt with Nonprofit Party, and today we are at the Natural History Museum in Los Angeles, and more specifically, we're in the Discovery Center. We are surrounded by bugs. What is the difference between a bug and an insect, and what are these behind us?
A lot of people use bugs for creepy crawly. The real bugs are actually one group of insects. But in here, they're really, it's a more appropriate term would be arthropod.
So, I mean, there are a lot of different things behind us, you guys. I mean, there's a spider that's bigger than my hand.
Our Brazilian salmon tarantula is the second largest in the world. So they'll grab their prey, and then they eat it by putting it into their fangs, and they inject venom, and it kind of helps to start the digestion process, and then they kind of suck all the juice out of it. So they eat that way. They kind of like vampires.
I was gonna say it's like a vampire spider. They suck the juice out.
Yeah. What is it about the roach that freaks you out?
I don't, you know, I think it's just like the idea of thinking of like roaches in the house. It's interesting. Mm-hmm. It's definitely, it's like a hard shell.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because his back, is that considered a tail? It's like it has ridges.
That's their abdomen, so it's just the ridged abdomen. This makes them really flexible animals. Cockroaches are really good at moving their body around.
You were telling me something really interesting earlier, mm-hmm. that a lot of people think that this should be our main food source.
Ecologists are starting to look at them as this really great protein source instead of the mammals that we usually eat or the chicken that we usually eat, because they are higher in protein, lower in fat per ounce, mm-hmm. believe it or not. They don't affect the soils like cows can. They can have a lot of little babies very quickly. Very small places to breed them, of course, so they take less land. Mm-hmm. So it's really good. It might be the future of agriculture. They're actually built for being on the ground. So they're built for eating whatever they need to come across. And so their head is right here. On the back side of him.
Oh, so he's facing the ground.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he's ready to eat, you know, whatever he comes uh-huh. across. They are very, very harmless.
So contrary to popular belief then, they do not actually carry any disease.
No, they don't carry them. They can carry like bacteria that's on your floor. They're actually quite clean. Very big name for a very little animal.
Does it feign death when it's threatened?
A lot of animals don't want to eat dead things. To prevent that from happening, they might play dead. They're on their back. They can actually flick themselves onto their back. The texture is really nice. It's also deceiving for birds. Birds don't see what they're eating. So if a bird picks this guy up, if it feels what it feels like, it's like, oh, this is a rock. I don't want to eat this rock.
So then it saves it. He's really hard. It's not like the roach where mm-hmm. there was the flexibility.
When insects pass away, usually people will put them on a collection yeah. and pin them on. They actually need a hammer to get through them.
Wow, it's that mm-hmm. hard.
It's really difficult.
That's amazing.
A lot of people will actually sell them at the bug fair for people to keep as pets. They're super easy to take care of.
Should you have more than one? Do they need friends?
Not necessarily, but they do fine together. She's a relative of the stick insects, and the ones that are really good at camouflage, of course. In with their environment by mimicking what they're around. The job of the female is to sit and eat, and the job of the male is to fly around.
I wish I were this bug.
And the male of their species is so rare that they only discovered them in the mid-90s, which is cool because how could they reproduce
yeah. if there's no male?
Well, that's the cool thing about the stick and the leaf guys. They can actually reproduce without a male.
Really?
They will create little clones of themselves. The males are needed, of course, for genetic diversity. The fact that there's so few of them that they didn't discover them until the 90s is just kind of incredible. You have yeah. to have a certain license yeah. to keep them as pets.
Like an exotic animal.
Yeah, like an exotic animal. Yeah, it's a USDA permit. The reason is because they reproduce so easily and eat so well and eat plants. They're considered an invasive species if they do get here.
We've talked about the bug fair a lot. It's mm-hmm. coming up in May. What is it exactly for people who have never been?
It's just a lot of cool stuff. Insects as food, which we've talked about. They have a lot of different vendors, which have bugs for pets, like our ironclad beetles. They have people that have insects like these pins, so you can have them for your collection. It's really amazing. So much fun.
It sounds like an awesome event, you guys. If you can make it, if you're in the LA area, definitely go to the bug fair. And if you can't get to the bug fair, you guys are here all the time, 7 days a week, right?
Yeah, to make sure that you guys connect with these things. I mean, these are interesting little animals that a lot of people have so many misconceptions about, and we want to make them better understood.
You guys, this has been so fascinating. These Madagascar hissing cockroaches are no longer as creepy crawly as I thought they once were. They're not really scary at all, in fact, and if you're in the right country, you can eat them more protein than an egg. So thanks for joining us on another episode of Nonprofit Party. I'm Zoe Hewitt. I'll see you next time.